Want to welcome you to this May 31st edition of our study in the book of Colossians, which will conclude our Colossian adventure and experience. We started this all the way back in November. It has gone through our Advent season, through the new year, through the virus crisis that we faced. And today we come to the conclusion of our study in the book of Colossians. So I want to thank you for tracking with me through these interesting and incredible verses of the Bible. This is a great book of the Bible. So many things about the nature and the person of Jesus Christ. And that's why I believe that the Lord laid that on my heart for that purpose. As we come to the conclusion today, I want us to look at this idea, this sentiment, being sent back. Sent back. So let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for this installment of our worship service, this installment of our study in Colossians and its conclusion, but also I thank you for the opportunity for us to be together. I pray, Lord, whether we are here in the parking lot or whether we are here through a virtual experience, that your word would go forth in our lives in a powerful and in an incredible way. And I'll just thank you and ask you through your Holy Spirit to minister to each of us in heart, in mind, and in spirit. And we'll thank you for that, Jesus, as we ask it in your name. Amen. As we conclude this study in the book of Colossians, we want to look at an interesting concept as we come to the end of the book, and that is the fact that there was a group of believers that is going to be sent back from Rome, where Paul is imprisoned, and Epaphras has come to consult him, a group from Paul's experience there in Rome, is going back to Colossae. Okay, so really, really an interesting thing. They're going back to Colossae. When we look at this, I want you to realize with me what they were sent back for. And we're going to look at four things that are in your outline that they were sent back for. And I'm trusting that at some point within this message, you're going to see an application for your heart and for your spirit. So let's take a look at the Word of God. We're going to begin with, again, Colossians chapter 4, and we're going to go to verse 2, and we're going to read this passage of Scripture again. But really, we're going to focus on the latter part, verses 12 and 18. But let's give attention to God's Word. Follow along in your version of the Scripture. Might be a little bit different than mine. It says this, Colossians 4, verse 2. Continue earnestly in prayer, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open to us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. Tychius, a beloved brother, faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord, will tell you all the news about me. I am sending him to you for this very purpose, that he may know your circumstances and comfort your hearts, with Onesimus, a faithful and a beloved brother who is one of you. They will make known to you all things which are happening here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you. With Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, about whom you received instruction. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice. These are my only fellow workers for the kingdom of God, who are of the circumcision. They have proved to be a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has a great zeal for you, and those who are in Laodicea, and those in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. Greet the brethren who are in Laodicea and Nymphas and the church that is in his house. Now, when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of Laodicea, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. This salutation by my own hand, Paul. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. Amen. The latter part of this concluding chapter of Colossians talks about a group of believers being sent now from Rome back to Colossae. Let me share with you a couple things you're going to need to know. First of all, Colossae was a place where Philemon, if you remember the book of Philemon, we've touched on it in the last couple weeks, the book of Philemon takes place. Philemon was from Colossae. Onesimus was a servant or a slave, a bondservant to Philemon and his family, apparently ran away and embezzled something, is the implication from that book. So know that Onesimus is being sent back to the place where he did what was wrong. I'm going to come to that in a little bit, but I don't want to get too far in front of myself. Let me share with you also something you need to know. There are some incredible stories and accounts in the Word of God and in church history about people who've been sent back. First of all, remember the disciples? We just came out of the Easter season. And during the Easter season, we need to realize something, that the disciples were in Jerusalem for Jesus' crucifixion. Following his resurrection, they went back to Galilee. But we know that Jesus ascended from Jerusalem 40 days after his resurrection. So not only did he send them back to Galilee, and I preached a little bit about that when we went in our Easter services in those 40 days, what they meant, but then he sent them back to Jerusalem. It was in Jerusalem that they saw his ascension. And it was in Jerusalem that they gathered together and Pentecost came, the power and the person of Holy Spirit upon them. That happened in Jerusalem. Peter's arrest, the martyrdom of our early church martyrs like James. Look, those things happened in Jerusalem. So they were sent back. They were sent right back to the most dangerous place for them. But before Jesus ever did that, he sent them back to the safest place they could be, to Galilee. And then he sent them back into danger, you know, just a little over a month after his resurrection. That's one of the great accounts in Scripture about being sent back. There's another one. And I love to preach on this topic. And that is the demoniac from Gadara. And that is in Mark chapter 5. You know the account. Let me just abbreviate it a little bit. There's a man who, of course, had a legion of demons. They couldn't restrain him. He even broke chains. He ran around the tombs. And he was just not the guy you're going to invite to your next party. But one of the things, he was violent. He, you know, He ran around naked. He was like a wild animal. And Jesus comes and casts the demons out of him. And there's this incredible thing where it says he was seated and clothed in his right mind at the feet of Jesus. And people, listen, and people were more amazed at that than all those pigs that ran off the cliff. Now, I'm not preaching on this topic. Let me hurry. The demoniac, when Jesus got onto the boat to go back over to the other side of Galilee or Gennesaret, he wanted to come with Jesus. I love this passage of scripture. He wanted to come. He knew who changed him. I trust you know who changed you. And that devotion never ever left him. And Jesus said, no, I want you to go back. Now, we're not necessarily told where he lived beforehand, but I want you to go back. I want you to show yourself to your family and your friends that you've been healed, that you've been restored, you've been redeemed, you've been set free. Go show them that. So he told him, no, you can't go with me. I'm sending you back. Now, stop there. I feel a little bit like Paul Harvey. Some of you will remember Paul Harvey when he told you, and here's the rest of the story. When Jesus came back to the other side of Galilee, he found a multitude waiting for him. Why? This man's witness. They came to see the prophet, the teacher, the man of God who was instrumental in the restoration of this guy. When Jesus came back, they were already waiting. They were there. And that's why he sent him back. Then one extra biblical account that we have, and that is the story of St. Patrick. St. Patrick, you know, the patron saint of Ireland, and we can talk about, you know, the shamrock, which is not exactly a perfect illustration of the Trinity, but hey. And who knows about these snakes, okay? But we do know that he was the patron saint of Ireland. But what you didn't know, maybe, in his account, is that he was actually brought up in Great Britain. His family was a Romanized Britannic family. He was then kidnapped by the Irish in a raid and taken and lived in Ireland as a slave, as a herdsman, for 6 years. He then finally escapes, takes the opportunity to then continue through Europe and studied, and then God gave a call to him to become a missionary to where? To Ireland, to the people who had stolen him. Incredible, incredible account of three sets of individuals who were all sent back. Now, let me get to the 4 points of this sermon. All of that is, well, all of that was just background. But here we go. Why was this group of people sent back? And the group of people that is going to be sent back are Tychius, Onesimus, Epaphras is going back because that's where he was the pastor. He was the leader of that congregation, and whoever came with him, which we don't know, are going back. The scripture tells us that Mark may even visit there. So they're going back to Colossae. Onesimus is going back to Philemon. Now not as a slave who was unprofitable, but now as a brother in the Lord. And he's going back to a group of people, all of whom knew him and knew of his failure. Incredible. But let's come back to the text. The first thing I want you to see in verses 7 through 9 is that they are going back, they are being sent back to report, to tell. First of all, Paul says they're going to come back and they're going to tell you about me. What's going on with me? Remember that Paul is imprisoned in Rome. He is underneath a house arrest where he has freedom and liberties. And some of them are bought, you know, but he has opportunity. While he is at Rome, at some point, somehow, he meets this Onesimus, and he calls him, you know, his son in chains, that he was begotten in the family of God because he and Paul met up in Paul's imprisonment. Now, I know you ought not to assume certain things, but, you know, for me, I think the part of the story is, where do you think the incarcerated Paul met Onesimus? You know, Onesimus ran away from Philemon. Apparently he ran away with some substance. And you get a good look at his character because he's arrested again in Rome for something and ends up meeting Paul. Now, it is entirely possible that Paul met him beforehand and met him in Rome. I don't know. But since we're not told that part, I'm just giving you that part of the story for me. As many of you know, when I end the story of the prodigal son, we're not told the end. I think that when the father comes out to the older son, he finally relents and comes into the party, but that's just me. Maybe that's the Hallmark version. We don't know what happened. That's not the point of the story, what happened. The point of the story was the issue of somebody who was lost, who is now found, and how we ought to treat somebody who is lost and found. So they are going to share news about Paul. The other thing it says, that they are going to find out their circumstance. Now remember, what we have is Epaphras coming to Rome from Colossae. Now he didn't get in a car and drive 3 days. It took a while to get there. And I am assuming that this was not a one and done thing. That he just didn't go in, plop down with Paul and said, look, we got problem 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, what do I do? I don't think that he went there and stayed a day. I think there was time that was spent. And then there had to be time to go back. And though there was a lot and ample travel in this day, it was not always very fast. And so they were going to know their circumstances. They were going to come and they're going to say, how are things going? How have things been going since we were gone? We brought an answer to your theological, doctrinal questions. We've brought them back. We want to share them with you. How have things been going since Epaphras has been gone? So it says that they went back to report news about Paul. They went back so that they could report back to Paul what they found in Colossae and how things were going. And then it says this, that they were to come to comfort their hearts. What an incredible picture. Paul says, they're coming to report to you what I have taught in this word, in this letter that I'm writing. They have come to give you comfort, to set your hearts at ease, to let you know that these are the things you need to be concerned about in your walk with Jesus Christ. This is how you can be successful and joyful. He tells them, look, I want you to understand they've come to comfort your hearts. And then he adds this thing. He says, then they came to report what was happening here. Now notice with me that they're going to tell them about Paul. You know, you have people in your life you want to know about, you know, and I'm not just talking about inquiring minds want to know, you know, very often Pat and I have the opportunity to sit down with people that we have pastored in the past and had a relationship. Recently, we got an opportunity to do that within the context of a wedding back in Watsontown. We sat down with this family and I was the pastor of Watsontown for 16 years. So their son who was married, I met him when he was like 7 years old. Okay, now he's getting married. But as he grew up, I watched the boy play football. We slip and slided together. I mean, he and his brother and his sister played in the worship team. I had a lot of contact with his family. So when we sat down, what did we do? We told each other about each other. Now, let me come back. Because what happens here is that in this passage, they are going to give a report of what Paul's asked them to pray about. How is the word of God going forth? How is the word of God moving in Rome? How is the word of God moving in the area? So they're not only telling him, not only telling the Colossae church about Paul, they're also telling them about the ministry there. I love to hear ministry stories, don't you? I mean, that's one of the things that we do during missions conference. Our missionaries come in, and during their time in the field, they share with us things that are happening there. Think of Mike and Ruth Davis, who will soon be back in Portugal, telling us about doing things for the very first time because they were missionaries sent there on the ground level of that brand new mission field. And that's exciting. Ministry that we've talked about with the Street Boys in our kids, our Coins for Kids and our Missions Moments lately. That is exciting, and that's what they were sent back for. The second thing that they were sent back for was to recognize. First of all, they wanted to recognize that the Lord is at work. One of the things that happens to us very often in the United States, and especially in the United States church, we live in a post-Christian era in the United States. And you can argue with me all you want. It's true. All you've got to do is look at what we wear, what we watch on television, some of the things that our government deals with, and you'll realize we are in a post-Christian era. Don't be afraid of that. Just recognize it. Sometimes we forget that the Lord is at work. We think that the power of hell and the gates of hell seem to be winning on our side of the pond. And yet, one of the things I would love to tell you and share with you is the fact in Africa, there's revival going on. I'd love to tell you that in South America, there's revival that's going on. There are more people being won on those two continents today in massive numbers, people turning to Jesus Christ. See, they wanted to go back to Colossae and say, not only is the Lord at work here, he's at work in Rome. He's at work in Laodicea. He's at work in Hierapolis. We want you to understand that he is at work. For us Christian Americans, underneath the guise of our society today being really, really contrary and anti-Christian, there are places in the world where God is booming. There's places in the United States that are undergoing really, really powerful ministries. And I am excited about that. They've also come to recognize the power of redemption. They sent back an object lesson. His name is Onesimus. Everybody, I assume, since Philemon is part of the Colossae church, knew the story of Onesimus. But what they didn't know was the rest of the story. How he was found by Paul and born again and now became a fellow laborer with Paul. And then all of a sudden is being sent back. You thought I forgot the title of the sermon. I didn't. He's being sent back. Being sent back to show them the power of redemption. It would be interesting one day if we just took the opportunity for a period of time to let each of us who know Jesus Christ to share our testimony, how we came to Christ, how we walk with him. I missed some of those evening service testimony times. Up until coming here to Punxsutawney, I've always had an evening worship service on Sunday. Not saying right or wrong, I'm just saying. And many of those evenings were filled with singing favorite songs and sharing testimonies. And that was great because it showed us the power of redemption. The power of redemption. And Paul says, look, Mark greets you. He's here with me. Now, do you think they didn't know about the sharp dissension that took place between Paul and Barnabas over Mark? How he failed, how he went and had a second chance and then became a protege of Peter, so that the gospel that he writes, Mark, have been told to us that he's giving you the reflection of Peter's account. But I want you to come back for a minute and realize that they are going back to, they are being sent back to, they are coming back to Colossae to show the power of redemption. There is nothing quite like a good testimony. The other day in the church office, we were talking about a contemporary Christian artist whose name was Barry Maguire. For those of you who grew up in the 60s, you may remember that Barry Maguire was a hit on the music circuit with a song called The Eve of Destruction. And if you haven't, you know, you can go to YouTube and find it, but be careful because YouTube can be dangerous. But you can look it up. That's what he said. He was on all the radio stations. He was on all the music TV shows with his Eve of Destruction. Well, he gets saved. He gets born again. And of course, We are quick sometimes in the church. We are quick in the church when somebody important or famous or rich or a sports athlete of notoriety gets saved. We want to put them out there, and the people that he was discipled by said, no, you won't do that. You know, you're going to have something to say when you start saying stuff. And so he was rooted and grounded, and then he made the circuit. You don't hear much about it then. One of our favorite songs that he did was Bullfrogs and Butterflies Have Both Been Born Again. We heard that with our children and sang it. Who is that? Barry Maguire. Well, who's Barry Maguire? Eve of Destruction Barry Maguire. I didn't know he got saved. And then he did a communion song. Still one of the neatest communion songs ever written. And here we have the power of redemption. The power of redemption. And they wanted to recognize that. And they sent along an object lesson. Then the other thing is that they were sent back to recognize that God had a blessing for them. God had a plan for them. And that plan and that blessing was to be perfect and complete in all of the will of God. That's a sermon all itself. Let me just hit a couple things about that statement. First of all, how many of us are perfect? You know, I came to Christ when I was a second semester freshman in college, at a secular college, of all things. I was very, very close to my 19th birthday when I gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. So I've been on the road a while. I'm not perfect yet. I know many of you think that I think that I am, but that's not true. I'm not. Neither are you. And neither is any believer. Bumper sticker, doctrine. Christians aren't perfect, they're just forgiven. But perfect and complete. You say, well, how can I be perfect and complete, Pastor? And I'm saying to you, do you realize that when you fail, when you falter, God is there if you will confess your sin, if you will repent of your sin and your shortcomings and the areas of your imperfection and your incompleteness and give them to Him, what does He do? He comes and He forgives you. He restores you. He sets you back where you were. That's part of His will too, isn't it? It sure is. Sometimes I think that we as Christians forget the fact that being forgiven and the issue of forgiveness, and that issue that we find in 1 John about having him cleanse us from all unrighteousness, all uncleanness, infers the point that we will have moments when we are not perfect. We will have moments when we will not feel complete. But in all the will of God, there is forgiveness. In all the will of God, there is restoration. In all the will of God, there is filling. In all the will of God, there is redemption. In all the will of God, you may have walked 10,000 steps away, but it's only one step back, said one of the great songs of a bygone group known Petra. In a song, Just Reach Out. You may have walked 10,000 steps away. It's only one step back. Why? Why? I'll tell you why. To recognize that being perfect and complete in all the will of God means that we have a lifestyle call on our lives that cannot in any way, shape, or form be mitigated because we are in the 21st century. Third thing that I want you to see, and that is the fact that they have been sent back to share. They've been sent back to share. First of all, they have been sent back to share the gospel in Colossae, Laodicea, and Hierapolis. They've been sent back for ministry. They've been sent back to that area which Epaphras has a burden for. And that burden compelled him to come to Paul so that the Colossae church would be solid and strong and be a place from which would be launched other ministries of the gospel. Now, if you're looking at your outline, I have put the gospel in Colossae, Laodicea, Hierapolis, a burden, and right in between there I put this little point that says the work of the gospel. We talk about the work of the gospel. It's an old phrase that's used. I can remember in early missions conference, going to council and going to district conference where we would bring back our international workers, our missionaries, and they would tell us about the work of the gospel. Now, you realize I got a point here, emphasizing the idea of work. You see, Christianity was never intended to be passive. It was never intended to be passive-aggressive. It was always intended to be at work, at work. This worship service, maybe for you it's work, but this is one of the joys that God has given in the calling of my life. But this is part of the work. Part of the work, teaching Sunday school, serving in the nursery, part of the work. Okay? Are you with me? The work, the active nature. You know, we're getting to the point where we're going to begin our indoor services again. And we're looking forward to the day when we'll be back in the sanctuary and that we will be back with Sunday school and Sunday evening programs and children's programs. We're looking forward to that. We're looking forward to that. That's all known as the work of the gospel. And they went back, were sent back, for the work of the gospel. The work of the gospel. Something we are active in. You see, work is the opposite of not working. Or if you would look at it, something very active, something very passive. I want you to understand that they came back. They were sent back. They were sent back to share the gospel in this area of the world. And they were sent back to a work of the gospel. And they were sent back out of a burden that wanted to be shared. And then that fourth point, as we conclude, they were sent to hold people accountable. Ooh, you say, Pastor, I am so glad this is the last point, because none of us necessarily like this concept and this idea. We don't very much like being told what to do. And we are very much not interested in us being told what to do and then somebody watching over to make sure we do it. But this is exactly what is happening here. I want you to realize they are sent back to hold this church, Colossae, this church, Laodicea, the work of the gospel in Hierapolis, to be accountable. Now, I placed three things about this accountability, and probably they are the application of this to each of our heart. How important is church? How important is church? You've often heard, and I'm sure you heard more than once during this period of time of social distancing and churches not having services, the idea that the Bible teaches us to forsake not the assembly of ourselves together. Now, I want you to know that I don't think that is fully embraced in virtual things. We need to be with each other. The church is a community. I'm not preaching on that. I'm just telling you, we need to find out just how important church is to us. He went back, and in all the things Paul said, he said, I want you to greet this man, Nymphas. And Nymphas has a church in his home. So he has a church in his home. My assumption, and it's only my assumption, that this church was in Laodicea. Now, it could have been in Colossae, I don't know. One of those two places, because they are prominently mentioned here. Anyway, how important was church that Paul writes them about it? Jesus said, I will build my church, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The church. Now, I know that's not one of the most popular topics to talk about. I know that in our day and age that sometimes church is not considered to be the most exciting thing that takes place at 11 o'clock on Sunday. But I want you to realize with me, if you would, it's important to Paul. And it's important to these early believers. It ought to be important to us. Ought to be important to us. It ought to be really important to us. I don't know if you have a list of things in your life that take priority. An opportunity to share this with somebody not too long ago, my list of priority. And so let me just share them with you. First of all, my first priority is in my relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ, period. Number one. Number two is my relationship to my wife. That's number two. Number three is my call to the ministry. Okay, you with me? Number four, you say, wait a minute, preacher, when are you going to get around to serving the church here, buddy? I'm coming to it. My relationship with Jesus, my relationship with Pat, my call to ministry, my family, my church. I don't know how you put things up there, but I think sometimes that people and their importance level, the church, puts it maybe 10th place, 20th place, 100th place. You may say, Pastor, you're kind of being snarky with us. Yeah, I am. Because you see, the church and your relationship to the church ought to be one of your top priorities. Your service in the church, your attendance to the church, your support of the church ought to be one of your top priorities. Nothing comes before your relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ has said, "This is my church." Enough said. Let me go on to the next thing, because this is the one where I get pointed at. Because he says, I want to hold accountable an individual, Archippus. Archippus, we want you to realize, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord that you may fulfill it. Why'd he get picked on? Because in this being sent back. They wanted to hold him accountable to his ministry. I want you to realize that I sense and have always sensed an accountability of my ministry. First of all, an accountability in my ministry to the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, my accountability to you as a local body of believers. Thirdly, my responsibility as a minister of the Christian and Missionary Alliance. Resident in its district, resident in its council. How important is ministry to me? Yeah, I love to preach. And somebody say, that's because you just like to stand up there and yell at us. Well, that's not bad either. But I want you to realize ministry is absolutely essential. Not only to me, but it ought to be to all of us. You say, well, I'm not a pastor. I don't have an REV in front of my name, and I don't have a college education. I don't have this, and 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 I can't do this, and I can't do this. Yeah, but do you know Jesus? If you know Jesus, you have a ministry. It may not be one that is very public, but you have a ministry. It may not be one that everybody says, oh, man, but you have a ministry. Every one of you who knows Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior have a package of giftings, and God wants you to fulfill those giftings, and he wants you to get on with the work of the gospel in those ministries. And then the last thing, and with it I close this study in the book of Colossians. They wanted to see, they were sent back to find out how important was the commitment of the Colossae church, the commitment to the Colossae church. Okay, you guys have some problems. Here's Paul's answer. Are you going to do them or not? Are you going to live them out or not? Are you going to be committed to this work of the gospel? Are you going to be committed to receiving Mark, are you going to be committed to the changes and the staunchness of what you believe in the midst of what is attacking you? Are you going to maintain your commitment? We have all sorts of commitments around us. Commitments in marriage, commitments in family, commitments at work, commitments in church, commitment to spouses. God is really interested in how you honor your commitments. That's really important to him. In the Old Testament and very often in the Psalms, you'll see about paying your vows. You know what it's asking, don't you? Where's your commitment? Where's your commitment? Now, I want you to know right now, it'd be real easy to allow this sermon to continue with just pummeling you and, in a sense, pummeling myself about just how important our commitment is. Our commitment to Jesus, our commitment to a lifestyle as Christian believers, our commitment to the Word of God, our commitment to holy, righteous, let me say it again, holy, righteous living, filled with the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit, endued by Holy Spirit, living out the fact that we love Jesus. I don't want to do that. Well, okay, part of me would like to do that. What I want you to do, just for a moment, is not have to be, in a sense, bullied and cajoled and to be told how rotten we are at commitment. I would rather have you come back and, for a moment, just gauge your commitment to the person and work of Jesus Christ, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but to take on flesh. The kenosis passage there in Ephesians. And gave himself. Onesimus is being sent back to the place where everybody knew his failure. How important was his commitment to the person of Jesus Christ to face what he's going to face, and the joy at that church and those people to receive him as a brother. That's exactly what Paul said in the book of Philemon they ought to do. So I'm asking you, not to sense and feel browbeat by this pulpit today, but to honestly look in the face of Jesus. Look into the indwelling Holy Spirit and deal with that issue of commitment. Will you do that? Because in a great sense, we are being sent back. We, you, me, are being sent back. One last account and then I'm done. A good many years ago, because of my ministry with youth at Mojave Camp, a group of students who went to the high school I went to invited me to come down and speak to their Bible club. I stood in the cafeteria where I ate lunch every school day. I stood in the halls, and at that time there were only a couple teachers left who were there when I was there, and shared with them the gospel of Jesus Christ. In a real sense, I got sent back. You and me, we've been sent back to do the same things this group of disciples and believers did. To report, to recognize, to share, and to hold accountable. Let's pray. Lord, I come before you right now, and I believe that every time we come to the Word of God, there's something we have to decide. There's something we have to live out. There's something that we have to gauge. And I pray for your Spirit to allow the people who've heard this to gauge those things, to deal with those things. And ultimately, Lord, know the strength of their commitment. And I'll thank you for this time as we ask it in Jesus' name. And all the people said, virtually, I trust, amen. Thank you.